From the poor treatment of animals to uneven food distribution and even climate change, lab-grown food is being hailed by some as a solution for many of today's biggest issues. Our global agricultural system is responsible for over a quarter of all greenhouse gas emissions. Among the worst offenders are beef, dark chocolate, coffee, and fish, based on emissions per kilogram. There has been a lot of hype around cell-cultivated food, but how viable is the industry? What does it entail? And more importantly, will consumers bite?
Can you do the honours and lift the lid on your creation?
Over a decade ago on The Edge, we reported on the world's first ever cultured beef burger. Unveiled by Professor Mark Post from Maastricht University, it cost around €250,000 to produce. He went on to set up Mosa Meat, a company which aims to bring the burger to the masses, and he's not alone. There are now hundreds of startups developing their own lab-grown products, but just how do they do it? It's a relatively simple procedure, and similar for both meat and plant-based production. For meat, simply take stem cells from animals' tissue, add a nutrient-rich solution and watch the cells multiply into the three main components of meat: muscle, fat, and connective tissue. Then put the cells into bioreactors, or as they're more commonly known, cultivators. These cells are then separated and rearranged to build a final edible product. This part of the process is called scaffolding and can be very complicated. A steak, for instance, needs a lot more scaffolding than ground meat in a burger. The entire process takes between 2 and 8 weeks, but the payoff can be huge. It's estimated that just 1/1000th of a pound of cow cells can create up to 4.4 billion pounds of beef. That sounds like an impressive return. So what's the holdup? Well, cost is a big issue. Currently, lab-grown meat is around 40% more expensive than animal meat. And then there's health and safety concerns. All production must happen in a completely sterile environment because the cells have no natural immunity from diseases. And while traditional meat is nutritionally dense, most of its proteins, vitamins, and minerals are introduced via animal feed. You have to add these nutrients into cultured meat, and it's still unclear whether today's additives provide equal nutritional value in the long term. As a result, regulators can't seem to align on the technology. Singapore became the first country in the world to approve cultured meat for human consumption in 2020. The US followed suit 3 years later, and the UK's Food Standards Agency approved use for pet food in early 2024. Italy, meanwhile, has banned the production, sale, and import of lab-grown meat entirely, with the government citing its potential negative impact on the country's farming industry. France and Romania might do the same. The EU so far has not offered any guidance, but if it does greenlight use, it could put Brussels on a collision course with angry farmers. Some critics are calling for more research into the environmental impacts of cultured food, especially if production is ramped up significantly. After all, the manufacturing process still requires an energy source, but those championing the industry believe the benefits outweigh the negatives. They say cultured food has the potential to dramatically reduce food waste, tantalize our taste buds with things we've never traditionally eaten, and could provide health benefits by tailoring food to nutritional needs, such as removing gluten or saturated fats without compromising on the taste. According to consulting firm McKinsey, cultivated meat could make up as much as 0.5% of the world's meat supply by 2030, making it a $25 billion global industry.